Willie, be creative.
Welcome to what I think is going to be a very important, enlightening, and eye-opening lecture tonight. One of the most popular television shows over the last many years is a TV show called Mythbusters. Have you all seen that? Have you seen Mythbusters? And tonight, we have with us a speaker who is eminently qualified to address some of the mythologies that have existed widely in the United States about the war in Vietnam. I am not going to try to identify those myths for you in the introduction to our speaker. Instead, I would like you folks to listen carefully and try to think about what myths he may be busting tonight. What are some preconceptions that you have had about Vietnam, about American soldiers in Vietnam, and what evidence is Dr. Turse bringing to bear tonight to perhaps dispel those myths? And moreover, I want you to think a little bit about why it is that some of these mythologies continue to exist so broadly in our society. So it's something just for you to think about, to use your critical thinking skills tonight. Nick Turse is an award-winning journalist, a historian, an essayist. Let me go back and talk. He's a historian. As a historian, I am very proud to number him as one of our kind. And for those of you who may be considering the study of history, or maybe you've already committed to it, there are many, many things that you can do as a historian, and certainly what you're going to hear tonight is going to give ample evidence to some very exciting work in the field of journalism that actually Nick has shared with me has been enhanced considerably by his background as a historian. So maybe in the question and answer, something that will come up a little bit. But he has been an essayist. He's the managing editor of a website called TomDispatch.com and the co-founder of Dispatch Books. And a fellow of the Nation Institute. Those of you who are familiar with the Nation magazine probably will understand a little bit of the editorial policy and the contributions that Nick makes on that front. He has written several books already. He's the author most recently of the book which he will be talking about tonight, Kill Anything That Moves, The Real American War in Vietnam. He has appeared on national television. He's been interviewed by Bill Moyers and other important journalists. And I think actually that Bill Moyers interview was one of the most interesting ones, since Bill Moyers himself was so deeply involved in the Lyndon Johnson White House. He has also written a book called The Changing Face of Empire, Special Ops, Drones, Spies, Proxy Fighters, Secret Bases, and cyber warfare. He has written, his first book was called The Complex, How the Military Invades Our Everyday Lives. He's also the editor of The Case for Withdrawal from Afghanistan. Nick has written for many, many important newspapers, including the Los Angeles Times, the San Francisco Chronicle, journals such as The Nation, Le Monde Diplomatique, Indies Times, Mother Jones, the Village Voice. He is the recipient of the Ridenour Prize of the National Press Club. He has a PhD from Columbia University and has continued to receive awards for his outstanding work in investigative journalism. So with that as a background, knowing some of his credentials, I'm going to turn it over to Nick Turse, and I want you all to welcome him.
Good evening. Can everybody hear me okay? No? I'll try and speak up a little louder. I've been talking all day, so my voice starts to fade. You know, just let me know and I'll try and amplify a little bit better. I just want to thank all of you for coming out tonight. Time is precious, so I truly appreciate you spending some of it with me. A lot of folks played a role in bringing me out here tonight, so I just want to acknowledge and express my gratitude to Tom, to Mike, Weis, and everyone here at Illinois Wesleyan, especially the Social Science Division, the Department of History, Asian Studies Team, and the Center for Human Rights and Social Justice. I appreciate all of them hosting me. So tonight, I thought I'd talk a bit about how I first came to the project that eventually evolved into my book, Kill Anything That Moves, and then read a short selection from the book about how the project evolved from there. And then I'm more than happy to open it up to Q&A. In my experience, generally the Q&A portion is the best part of the presentation because it relies on all of you, so I want to leave as much time as possible for that. Before I begin, I want to apologize to any Vietnamese speakers in the audience for my exceptionally woeful pronunciations. And I spoke to a lot of students today, so I'm going to apologize in advance if I repeat any of the stories. I'm going to try and stick to a new script tonight. So I guess I should start by saying that I never intended to write a history of U.S. war crimes and Vietnamese civilian suffering. I never intended to spend more than a decade immersed in a veritable sea of atrocities. And I never even intended to personally study the Vietnam War. You know, basically I stumbled upon this project. When I was a graduate student at Columbia University, I had a job working on a project on post-traumatic stress disorder among Vietnam veterans. And the project was otherwise populated by epidemiologists, biostatisticians, social psychologists, psychiatrists, and I was the lone representative of the humanities on this project, the one historian. And it was my job to find hard data, because what we had were so-called self-reports, basically detailed, structured clinical interviews done with veterans about 10 years after the end of the war. And the knock on this always was that you can't tell if these veterans are telling the truth about their service. So it was my job to verify. I would go down to the National Archives and I'd try and find records that I could match up so we could place a veteran at a specific place at a specific time. And from there, my job on the project evolved further. And I went to find more granular material to flesh out what we knew about the war, to add context, and to search out other records that we could use to create measures and have a more nuanced understanding of the war. So on one of these trips down to the National Archives, I'd been there for about 2 weeks. And every research avenue that I tried was just, like a dead end. I just smacked into one brick wall after another. And at the end of 2 weeks, I had nothing. And I was exasperated, and I went to an archivist that I normally work with, and I said to him, look, I can't go back to my boss empty-handed. I need something, at least a lead, or he's never going to send me back down here again. And I'd gotten used to heading down to the National Archives for a couple weeks at a time, doing some of my own research on the side, and so I was looking for a way to keep that going. And he thought about this for all of 5 seconds before he asked me a question that ended up changing my life. He asked me if I thought that witnessing war crimes could cause post-traumatic stress. And I said to him, that's an excellent hypothesis. What do you have on war crimes? And he told me about a group of files called the Vietnam War Crimes Working Group Records. And I said, why don't you pull those for me? And he did. And within an hour, I was leafing through about 30 archival boxes filled with reports of massacres, murder, rape, torture, assault, mutilation, horrific crimes reported by active duty GIs and recently returned Vietnam veterans, that were investigated by the Army's own criminal investigators. And I looked at all of this, and I knew fairly quickly that it wasn't in the literature anywhere. And I asked the archivist, I said, who's worked with this material? And he said to me, people have looked at one or two cases, but never really at the whole collection. And eventually I learned why. It took some research to figure it out, but this was a secret Pentagon task force that assembled all these files. They operated unofficially, it was off the books, out of the Army Chief of Staff's office. At the time, that was General William Westmoreland. A couple of years before, he had been America's top commander in Vietnam. And he had a real vested interest in how the war would be seen. And just a couple months before this group was created, there was the exposure of the My Lai massacre. That had happened on March 16, 1968. 500 Vietnamese civilians were killed over a period of 4 hours by US troops. And a year and a half after that, the cover-up was unraveled. It hit the newspapers, and it was a PR disaster for the Army. So a decree came down from the Nixon White House, no more surprises like this. And it reached Westmoreland's office, so he created this task force. It was a group of colonels under the command of a brigadier general, a one star. And their job was to track all war crimes cases to make sure that the military was never caught flat-footed by an atrocity scandal again. And then they developed a second skill, and that was tamping down allegations whenever they could. And they became very adept at it. And because of that, nobody really knew that these records existed. They had closed up shop in around 1974. The records were packaged away, and since it was never on the books, no one had ever looked for these records. So I found them. I thought they were extremely important, and I went back to New York. I went to my boss, sat down, and I told him all about it. So this is a significant collection of records, and he said to me what any good epidemiologist would. He said, are the records systematic? And I told him no. I said, that's not how war crimes cases go. I said, it's only the rare case that ever bubbles up and becomes publicly known. Very few cases that ever make it to the Pentagon's, in front of the eyes of the Pentagon. And he said to me, so what do we do with this? And I didn't have a good answer for them. They were useless for our study, but I knew they were significant. So I called up a few Vietnam War historians that I knew, and I tried to get them interested in working with the records. And everybody had an excuse. They were just at the beginning of a new project, or right at the end of it, or they were burnt out on the war. And finally, one of them, a historian that I really respected named Chris Oppie, said to me, why are you trying to shop these records to me? You should write this. And it was a daunting prospect. I was a grad student. I was 200 pages into a different dissertation at the time. And he said, you need to write this book. Get the records immediately and write the book right away. Don't wait. So I said, oh, okay. I kind of just on the phone there, kind of came to the conclusion that I would do it. And it was Chris's faith in me, really, that convinced me. He had said, you're young. And at the time, I still actually was. And he said, you were born after the war, you'll have a fresh take on all this. And because of that, I said, okay, then maybe I can do it. So I marched into my advisor's office at Columbia, and I said, and this is what Chris told me. He said that I should write this book right away from these records. He said, do you think that I could write my dissertation and this book at the same time? And he shook his head at me and said, how are you going to do both things? He said, but these records are the dynamite you say they are. They're that important. Then drop the dissertation, write the book as your dissertation. Write that. So again, I didn't need a whole lot of prompting. I think then and there, I just said to him, okay, I'll do it. And he said also, go down and get the records right away. Make sure they don't disappear. And I said, I said, you know, I think you're being paranoid. I mean, these are old records. You know, I don't think they're going anywhere. They've been sitting on the archive shelves for years. And he said, get down there. So, you know, as I'm sitting there trying to work this out in my head, you know, I was a grad student at the time. I didn't have a lot of money. And I said, well, I think in 6 months, I can put together some grant proposals, get the money, go down there, get a hold of the records. And you know, again, he just shook his head at me and said, you're not listening. You have to get down there now. And he opened his desk drawer, reached in, pulled out his checkbook, and he wrote me a check then and there. And he said, here's the money. Go down and get the records. So I didn't have any excuses then. So within 24 hours, I was down in the National Archives. I'd go in first thing in the morning, sign out the copier for the entire day, and stand there in front of the copy machine, copy all day until he threw me out at night. At night, I went and you know, I took every cent that he gave me and put it into the copying. So I went out and slept in the archives parking lot in my car. I was very lucky. I had an SUV at the time that I kept like a complete pigsty. It was filled with old newspapers, crumpled up journal articles, assorted trash. So at night I would crawl into the back, pull a blanket over me, sprinkle the trash over that, and I would sleep there. And every night, the federal security guard would come by with a flashlight, shine it in the back, and I would hold my breath. I remained completely still so he didn't catch me, and luckily he never did. I used to put a sign on the dashboard that said, car broke down, tow truck coming tomorrow. And then every morning I would move the car to a different level in the archives parking garage. And I was lucky they never caught on, so I within a few days I had the entire collection. I was driving back towards New York, and I had all these documents. I wrote my dissertation from it. And, you know, it turned out that, you know, I thought my advisor was paranoid about getting those documents, but it turned out to be great advice, because after I wrote my first article from these documents, which was in the Village Voice, documents were pulled from the archive shelves, and they've never been available in the same way since. Today, if you want to go see the War Crimes Working Group collection down at College Park, Maryland, you can see about 20% of those records. They're publicly available, at least the last time I checked. The other 80%, you need to file a Freedom of Information Act request for each and every file folder in the collection. And the last time I checked, there was not a file list. So it's a classic catch-22. Unless you know what files are available, how can you ever FOIA them up? And so that's the state of limbo that these records are in right now. The archive says that they will return them to the public shelves one day once they get the redactions done. You know, it's been almost a decade now, and they still haven't gotten through that task. So one of these days, I hope. So you know, maybe I'll wrap up there. I'll do a short reading about how the project evolve some, and then we'll open it up and we can talk some. In hundreds of incident summaries and sworn statements in the War Crimes Working Group files, veterans laid bare what had occurred in the backlands of rural Vietnam, the war that Americans back home didn't see nightly on their televisions or read about over morning coffee. A sergeant told investigators how he put a bullet, point blank, into the brain of an unarmed boy after gunning down the youngster's brother. An Army Ranger matter-of-factly described slicing the ears off a dead Vietnamese and said that he planned to continue mutilating corpses. Other files documented the killing of farmers in their fields and the rape of a child carried out by an interrogator at an army base. Reading case after case, like the incident in which a lieutenant, quote, captured two unarmed and unidentified Vietnamese males, estimated ages 2 to 3 and 7 to 8 years, and killed them for no reason, unquote. I began to get a sense of the ubiquity of atrocity during the American War. In the years that followed, with the War Crimes Working Group documents as that initial guide, I began to track down more information about little-known or never-revealed Vietnam War crimes. I located other investigations files at the National Archives, submitted requests under the Freedom of Information Act, interviewed generals and top civilian officials, and talked to former military war crimes investigators. I also spoke with hundreds of veterans all across the country, both those who had witnessed atrocities and others who had committed terrible acts. From them, I learned something of what it was like to be 20 years old with few life experiences beyond adolescence in a small town or an inner city neighborhood, and to be suddenly thrust into villages of thatch and bamboo homes that seemed ripped straight from the pages of National Geographic. Veteran after veteran told me about days of shattering fatigue and the confusion of contradictory orders, about being placed in situations so alien and unnerving that even with their automatic rifles and grenades, they felt scared walking through hamlets of unarmed women and children. My conversations with the veterans gave nuance to my understanding of the war, bringing human emotion to the sometimes dry language of military records, and added context to the investigation files that often focused on a single incident. These men also repeatedly showed me just how incomplete the archives had come upon really were, even though the files detailed hundreds of atrocity allegations. In one case, for instance, I called a veteran seeking more information about a sexual assault carried out by members of his unit, which I found mentioned in one of the files. He offered me more details about that particular incident, but also said it was no anomaly. Men from his unit had raped numerous other women as well, he told me, but neither those assaults nor the random shootings of farmers by his fellow soldiers had ever been formally investigated. Over time, following the leads from veterans I'd spoken to and from other sources, I discovered additional long-forgotten court-martial records, investigation files, and related documents in assorted archives and sometimes in private homes across the country. Paging through one of these case files, I found myself virtually inhaling decades-old dust from half a world away. The year was 1970, and a small U.S. Army patrol had set up an ambush in the jungle near the Minh Tan rubber plantation in Binh Long province, north of Saigon. Almost immediately, the soldiers heard chopping noises, then branches snapping, and Vietnamese voices coming toward them. Next, a man broke through the brush. He was in uniform, they would later say, as was the entire group of Vietnamese following behind him. In an instant, the Americans sprang the ambush, setting off two Claymore mines, each sending 700 small steel pellets flying more than 150 feet in a lethal 60-degree arc and firing an M60 machine gun. All but one of the Vietnamese in the clearing were killed instantly. The unit's radio man immediately got on his field telephone and called in 10 enemy killed in action. Later, however, something didn't ring right at headquarters. Despite the claim of 10 enemy dead, the Americans had no weapons to show for it. With the My Lai massacre trials garnering headlines back in the United States, the commanding general of the 25th Infantry Division did something unusual. He asked the division's office of the inspector general, whose job it was to probe instances of alleged misconduct, to investigate. The next day, a lieutenant colonel and his team arrived at the site of the ambush, where they found the corpses of 5 men, 3 women, and 2 children scattered on the forest floor. None were wearing enemy uniforms, and civilian identification cards were found on the bodies. The closest thing to a weapon was a piece of paper with, quote, a small drawing of a rifle and of an airplane. The soldiers who sprang the ambush claimed that it was evidence the dead were enemy fighters, but the lieutenant colonel noted that it looked like, quote, something a child would do. Similarly, the makings of booby traps found on the bodies and cited by the soldiers as evidence of hostile intent turned out to be a harmless agricultural tool. As the American investigators photographed the corpses, it was apparent that the Vietnamese had been civilians, carrying bags of bamboo shoots and a couple handfuls of limes. Regular people just trying to eke out an existence in a war-ravaged landscape. The lime gatherers' deaths were typical of the type of operation that repeatedly wiped out civilians during the Vietnam War. Most of the times, the non-combatants who died were not herded into a ditch and gunned down as at me lie. Instead, the full range of the American arsenal, from M16 rifles and Claymore mines to grenades, bombs, mortars, rockets, napalm, and artillery shells, was unleashed on forested areas, villages, and homes where perfectly ordinary Vietnamese just happened to live and work. As the Inspector General's report concluded in this particular incident, the Vietnamese victims were innocent civilians loyal to the Republic of Vietnam. Yet, as so often happened, no disciplinary action of any type was taken against any member of the unit. In fact, their battalion commander stated that the team had performed exactly as he expected them to. The battalion's operation officer explained that the civilians had been in an off-limits or free fire zone, one of the many swaths of the country where everyone was assumed to be the enemy. Therefore, the soldiers had behaved in accordance with the U.S. military's directives on the use of lethal force. It made no difference that the lime gatherers just happened to live there, as their ancestors undoubtedly had for decades, if not centuries, before them. It made no difference that, as the local province chief of the U.S. allied South Vietnamese government told the army, the civilians in the area were poor, uneducated, and went wherever they could to get food. The Inspector General's report pointed out that there was no written documentation regarding the establishment of a free fire zone in the area, noting with bureaucratic understatement that doubt exists that the program to warn Vietnamese civilians about off-limits areas was either effective or thorough. But that too made no difference. As the final report put it, the platoon had operated within its orders, which had been given and or sanctioned by competent authority. The rules of engagement were not violated. Seeking to connect such formal military records with the actual experience of the ordinary Vietnamese people who lived through these events, I made several trips to Vietnam, making my way to remote rural villages with an interpreter at my side. The jigsaw puzzle pieces were not always easy to align. In the files of the War Crimes Working Group, for example, I located an exceptionally detailed investigation of a massacre of nearly 20 women and children by a U.S. Army unit in a tiny hamlet in Quang Nam province on February 8, 1968. It was clear that the ranking officer there had ordered his men to, quote, kill anything that moves, and that some of the soldiers had obeyed. What was less clear was exactly where there was. With only a general location to go by, 15 miles west of an old port town known as Hoi An, we embarked on a shoe leather search. Inquiries with locals led us to An Trung, a small hamlet with a monument to a 1968 massacre. But this particular mass killing took place on January 9th, 1968, rather than in February, and was carried out by South Korean forces allied to the Americans, rather than by US soldiers themselves. It wasn't the place we were looking for. After we explained the situation, one of the residents led us to another village not very far away. It too had a memorial, this one commemorating 33 locals who died in three separate massacres between 1967 and 1970. However, none of these massacres had taken place on February 8, 1968 either. After interviewing villagers about these atrocities, we asked if they knew of any other mass killings in the area. Yes, they said, not the next hamlet down the road, but a little bit beyond it. So on we went. daylight was rapidly fading when we arrived in that hamlet and found a monument that spelled out the basics of the grim story in spare terms. U.S. troops had killed dozens of Vietnamese there in 1968. Conversations with the farmers made it clear, though, that these Americans were Marines, not Army soldiers, and the massacre had taken place in August. Such is the nature of investigating war crimes in Vietnam. I thought I was looking for a needle in a haystack. What I found was a veritable haystack of needles. Thank you. The files were, it's actually called the Vietnam War Crimes Working Group. That's the real title of these records. And they called themselves the War Crimes Working Group, which is kind of exceptional. Even most military people that I talked to about it doubted that such a group could have existed. But I think because it was off the books, they didn't mind using that terminology. And I talked to men who had served in that unit and said, you know, that's what they called themselves.
Do you think the number of war crimes that occur in Vietnam is abnormally high? And if so, why?
You know, it's very tough to...
Can everybody hear the questions?
No, not really.
Maybe you can repeat the question.
Sure. The question is whether or not atrocities in Vietnam were abnormally high, or if that's similar to other wars. And of course, I've never looked at other wars in the same depth. It's tough to compare, you know, one war to another, but you know, atrocities aren't endemic to warfare, and modern warfare is especially tough on civilians. You know, since World War I, you know, the civilians have been the predominant casualties of warfare. So it's you know, this is the trend line that we've been seeing. You know, the generals who fought World War I watched their armies get chewed up on battlefields, and I think they resolved that they would never do that again. And from World War I onward, you see that the war has really literally come home. Civilians have been predominant victims and been targeted specifically. Heavy firepower turned on civilian populations. So, you know, in modern warfare, this is very much, you know, how wars are fought. Vietnam, the confluence of a lot of different events that led to this, firepower being one. I try and tease out some of the threads in the book, and I can talk about them in more detail if people are interested. Racism certainly played a part. This is something that a lot of veterans I interviewed talked about, a racialized aspect of the warfare. The very metric that the war was fought on. So I mentioned it's not like World War I. You have two armies facing off. You're not trying to capture territory or take an enemy capital. The military was looking for a way to show that they're making progress. And what they settled on, this is Robert McNamara's Pentagon, was the metric of body count, that you would basically kill your way to victory. The idea was that you pile up the bodies, eventually you'd reach this mythic crossover point where the Vietnamese were losing more enemy fighters than they could put in the field. And at that point, the rational thing to do was to sue for peace. They could say, you know, we can't win this war, we'll make peace with the Americans. It's a complete misreading of Vietnamese history. Vietnamese had fought the Chinese for a millennia for their independence. They'd fought the Japanese during World War II, the French, who we bankrolled after World War II, and then they saw this continuation. So they weren't looking at it as a cost-benefit analysis, but the U.S. could never wrap their head around that. And out in the field, there was tremendous pressure on troops to produce bodies, and they learned very quickly that their commanders didn't much care who those bodies belonged to. The dictum in Vietnam was, if it's dead in Vietnamese, it's VC, or Viet Cong, the guerrillas. And you know, troops learned very quickly that you could kill civilians, call them in as enemy dead, and all commanders cared about was that number, body count. So you know, there were a lot of ways that the war was primed to be very tough on civilians, but it's very much in the very much as modern warfare is now.
Vietnam is not an exception, though. No. What the U.S. did in the Philippines around 1900 to 1908. It's what the U.S. did in different ways in Korea when I was in the Air Force. It's what the U.S. did just a few years ago in Fallujah, which is as bad as anything that happened during the Vietnam War.
Yeah, you know, this is something I talked about in one of the courses earlier today. Yeah, it was, you know, you can find real similarities to the Philippines insurrection. You know, the order given, and this is at the turn of the 20th century, America had gone to Philippines to fight the Spanish as part of the Spanish-American War, and ended up after that fighting the Filipino nationalists who were looking for their own independence. And you know, one of the orders handed down on the island of Samar there was to turn it into a howling wilderness. The order that came down was that anyone over the age of 12 was fair game. You can see the racialized aspect of war in the Philippines actually carry through to Vietnam. In the Philippines, the Filipinos were derided. The slur that was used, the racial slur, was that they were goo-goos. I'm not sure where it actually came from, but this is what the Marines called them, transmuted into the word gook. And I apologize for using the language. But this is, that word gook traveled with the Marines when they fought the so-called banana wars in Haiti and Nicaragua. They called the Haitians and Nicaraguans that they fought in the 1920s and 30s, they called them gooks. It was used to some degree in World War II, although nip was the slur of choice generally. In Korea, they called them gooks, and then it came full circle back to another American war in Southeast Asia, where the Vietnamese were derided as gooks, and the shorthand in the military was called the MGR, the mere gook rule. The idea was that the Vietnamese weren't real people. They were subhuman, mere gooks that you could kill or abuse at will. So you can see this this racialized aspect of the warfare, and it's something that veterans talk to me about all the time. They said that when they first got to boot camp, to basic training, they were told immediately, you never call them Vietnamese. You call them gooks or dinks, slants, slopes, rice eaters, anything to take away their humanity, anything to make it easier to kill them. I talked to a lot of minority veterans over the years who told me that when they got to boot camp, they heard this and they knew exactly what this was. I mean, this was the racism that they faced back home, different term, but the same mindset. And they vowed to themselves they would never use this language. But they heard it over and over again during boot camp. They heard it during advanced infantry training. They heard it during in-country training in Vietnam. And then out in the field, that's what everyone called Vietnamese. It didn't matter if they were allied South Vietnamese forces or enemy troops, civilians. They were gooks. And they said that, you know, this just, and they felt overtaken by this terminology. They felt powerless against it almost, and they ended up using it, and they ended up adopting that mindset. And they said that it made it easier to kill. So, you know, you can see this, you can see this in other wars and antecedent wars, and yes, there were civilian casualties through all American wars.
Yeah. Is there any talk of prosecution for war crimes? I mean, the Germans in their 90s are standing trial for war crimes. Why isn't that happening, or is it?
Well, there's no, certainly no political will to do that. The military claims that it's impossible to call men back to service to be prosecuted. The only real mechanism in this country for prosecuting quote-unquote war crimes is under the Uniform Code of Military Justice, which doesn't actually prosecute any Americans ever for war crimes. If you're prosecuted, it's for a regular crime, murder, rape, assault, whatever. But only enemies get prosecuted for war crimes. But the military claims it's impossible under a Supreme Court decision from the 1950s, the Toth case. And they've stuck to this line for years. But I found documents that suggested otherwise. It's the Army's top lawyer. In the wake of the My Lai massacre, the Army asked, is there a way to prosecute soldiers who have left military service, as many of them had by that point. And he said, most definitely, there were two legal mechanisms to do so. And it was all there in black and white, been read by Pentagon brass. And I called him up. He was still a high-priced lawyer in Washington, D.C. And I said, I asked him about it. He said he stood by those opinions. He said that that was the law. It was legally correct. Men could be called back to service. And I said, so why weren't they? And he said, political will. He said, you know, the Nixon White House certainly was not going to do this. And without buy-in by the White House, it was impossible. Of course, it really wasn't necessary to go all the way up that when I looked at the war crimes working group files, you look at the 800 or so cases in there, and very few were ever in very few cases were charges ever leveled, and even fewer cases where charges were preferred. Was there a court martial convened? In even fewer cases still, was there a conviction at court martial? And then almost never was anyone actually in prison for any period of time. The most significant conviction in the war crimes working group files is a 20-year sentence handed down for, I think I mentioned it in the reading, it was a rape of a child by a military interrogator on a base. And he got sentenced to 20 years of hard labor. And he ended up serving, I don't exactly remember, it's in the book, something like 4 months in prison before he was released. And that was that's indicative of what happened in these records. So there's really no will at any part of the military justice system for this, and certainly none now to call anyone back.
All right, from what I took, there's 20 files that are semi-public.
Yeah, on the public shelf, so you could go down there and take a look at
and
today.
And how many were you able to get a hold of?
The entire collection.
Did you yourself or via someone else able to synthesize? Was there a theme between those 20 and why those 20 were the 20 given or produced?
You know, I didn't look too closely at which 20 it was, or if I did, I don't really remember now, but it didn't look to me like there was a real rhyme or reason to it. It really looked like they were just proceeding through, and I don't think they had actually cherry-picked cases, if I'm remembering right. I don't
Whether
think
it was
so.
A theme or not, I mean, yeah. Were they, fair within the severity, or?
Yeah,
a little bit of everything.
I just don't remember. There were several hundred of these cases where they did really rigorous investigations, and many hundreds more that they summarily closed in various different ways. So, just looking at the numbers, I'd have to assume that most of them were cases that were closed and not the most detailed cases. I think they did kind of proceed from the beginning of the collection, so. Actually, they wouldn't be the most significant cases that are available right now.
You originally said 20%. How many cases would that involve if it was 20% of the whole?
No, it's, this was...
About?
Yeah, I'm trying to think, because there's different types of records in these collections. They're not all case files. Some of this is, some of it's the paperwork that was generated by the War Crimes Working Group. I would guess that this is, it's only dozens of cases out of this that are available, that amount of paperwork, several dozen, I guess. But I haven't looked at that list in a long time.
Yeah. Has there been a war crimes reported against indigenous tribes of Vietnam, such as the Red Mole or Red
Mole? Yeah, most of the so-called Montagnard tribesmen, they had sided with the Americans in most cases. They worked with Special Forces A teams, a lot of the ethnic minorities, because they had a great You know, they had great antipathy for the South Vietnamese government, but also for the revolutionary forces, and went their own way. So generally, they weren't targeted in the same ways, but on the ground in Vietnam, I went into they're called Hre, is the particular ethnic minority, Hre villages, and a couple that experienced massacres. And I talked to the people there, and they said they had no idea what was going on. They didn't even speak Vietnamese at the time. They only spoke their own language. They said they didn't know anything about the guerrillas. They said sometimes they saw guys in quote-unquote black pajamas, which that's what the Americans called what the guerrillas and what normal farmers were. They said they came through, they didn't speak their language, and the guerrillas didn't speak theirs, so they didn't spend time in the village. But the Americans, they were just all Vietnamese, or all oops to them, and they destroyed these villages and killed people there, and these people had no part whatsoever in the war. But most of the files I had don't deal with the ethnic minorities. They're with the majority of the Kin population.
Just want to say I was going to school here during this war, and we knew what was going on, more or less. I mean, we didn't know all the details, but what did carpet bombing mean? What did free fire zones mean? We knew. Sure. I mean, it was kind of like making us crazy. I mean, there was the counterculture then, and that's part of the reason why. But you couldn't walk across the college campus then without seeing anti-war sentiment. There were signs in the dorm windows, there were big warning buttons, there was just constant talk. You know, to me now, to walk across the college campus and see no expressions of anti-war sentiment, it's just heartbreaking. And I'll just say, the paper is at Fair. Thank Veterans for Peace for being here. One of the lead articles is by our author here.
No. So, I didn't even know that.
Yeah, I mean, this is something that I go into at the end of the book. I mean, the anti-war movement, really drew attention to this and put out a tremendous amount of literature that dealt with atrocities in Vietnam, churning out a lot of material. But after the war, this was all cast as propaganda, and it's really disappeared from the literature. No mainstream historians that I know really consult that literature anymore. It's frowned upon in the field. So they didn't go to it. I went back and looked at some of this, and there was also a good deal of literature coming out of Vietnam at the time, translated things, often really poor translations, but they make it to the States, and they had titles which were just the worst possible titles for establishing mainstream credibility. It'd be something like War Crimes of the American Imperialists and their lackey puppets in Saigon, something like that is the title. And of course, no one paid any attention to this, but I went and looked at some of these cases in the book, and then I went in Vietnam and tried to track them down, and I could find them there. I went to villages and interviewed people, and it matched up pretty well to what was in the book. It's pretty decent reporting for trying to do this in a war zone when you have a jungle printing press. And so that literature existed then, and now it sits on either gathering dust in library shelves or more and more. It's been moved out to off-site storage in most even university libraries. So I hope that someone will take a look at this literature again and maybe do some more legwork on it, because the anti-war movement was onto it. You mean afterward?
No.
Because of,
when they were training, were there guys, we're going to train you guys to basically kill everybody
and... was there training that led to atrocities? There's those racial aspects that I talked about. I talk a little bit in the book about changes in the way that training with your rifle when in Vietnam. Prior to this, a lot of the training was you lie prone on the ground, fired the rifle at a circular target. And in Vietnam, they introduced human forms, something they called the quick kill method, which was basically that you don't have to aim because you have an automatic rifle, an M16. This is your weapon. So you don't have to be careful about aiming. What you can do is you see a figure pop up, you turn, and you spray. And this quick kill method was used to counter very low firing rates that the military found it had during World War II, a natural resistance to shooting an enemy. World War II, the studies, they're a little iffy, but they said about a 45% firing rate. People would fire on enemy troops. Otherwise, they'd shoot above them. They would hold their rifle and not fire. And in Korea, they had gotten this up to 55%. In Vietnam, the study said 95%. So wherever you saw human form, men fired on it. And in Vietnam, the guerrillas didn't stand toe-to-toe with the Americans. The Americans had too much firepower. So they would fire from concealment and run. So you saw a fleeting glimpse of someone running in quote-unquote black pajamas. And this is what most people fired at in Vietnam. A glimpse of someone in this clothing. They were trained in this, and many times I talked to men who, they said they were scared out of their minds, and they fired on anyone they saw. And sometimes it was a gorilla with a rifle, and sometimes it was a woman farmer who was carrying like a hoe, and from a distance you couldn't tell who it was, but you saw someone running with something in their hand, and you just opened up. So that was one mechanism along those lines during the formative training that certainly led to had disastrous consequences for civilians.
So you said that you did interviews on the ground in Vietnam in rural villages. I would just like to know if there's still any anti-American sentiment among the people or what long-term effects you had on the Vietnamese people in the country.
I did a great deal of investigations in Vietnam, and this I always expected there to be animosity. I think as an American, I expected people to be angry and want revenge. and this is not what I encountered. Far from it. I was amazed at how open people were. I was a stranger who dropped in out of the blue. Most of the time, people told me, that I was the first American to visit the village since the war. Maybe the first unarmed Westerner who ever came to the hamlet. They'd only ever known French troops and American troops. And people were very forthcoming, willing to talk. And afterwards, invariably, they would thank me. And I always had a tough time wrapping my head around it. But they would always say that they were amazed that there was a American who knew something about what their hamlet had suffered during the war, that someone would travel halfway around the world to listen to their story. And in most cases, they hadn't had an opportunity to ever tell anyone about it. And they said they were grateful for it, and they wanted to help me to try and tell the American people about the war, because I said, this isn't in our history books. And it really isn't in theirs either. The civilians aren't in the Vietnamese narrative of the war generally. And very, very open and forthcoming. And it was my first trip to Vietnam. It really changed the project for me. I'd written a dissertation from these war crimes working group records, and I intended to write a book specifically about American atrocities in Vietnam. And I got to Vietnam with these big stacks of documents in my hand. I'd go into a village to talk to people about one particular massacre, one horrific spasm of violence. And what they would tell me about again and again was what it was like to live for 10 years under bombs and artillery shells and helicopter gunships, and how they had to negotiate every aspect of their lives around what they call the American War. They would tell me, what it was like to have their home burned down 4, 5, 6 times before they gave up rebuilding it and took to living a semi-subterranean existence in a bomb shelter. And what it was like to live down there all the time, be out farming in your field, and then artillery would be called down on the hamlet or on the rice fields, and the people would run to that bomb shelter. And then it was a waiting game, and it was from that moment on, it's life or death decisions, because they knew that was preparatory artillery. They knew that that preceded an American ground operation, that Americans would be coming into the village. So you had to stay in that bomb shelter long enough that you weren't killed by the artillery barrage. But you know, if you left the confines of that bomb shelter, you know, if you didn't leave the bomb shelter before the Americans got into the village, they would start rolling grenades into it. Because to them, it wasn't a bomb shelter, it was a possible enemy fighting position. And they weren't going to take the chance of having to go in there and clear it out. They would just roll grenades in. So you had to figure out a way to get out of there. But if you left a second too early, you'd be cut down by a helicopter gunship flying overhead, or get caught in a crossfire between the onrushing Americans and the withdrawing guerrillas. And as I heard these stories again and again, I heard about how you had to make all these life or death decisions for everything, from foraging for food, or to feed a hungry family, or farming, or getting some water, or even going out to relieve yourself. And I thought about that scale of suffering, that, you know, having to live like that for 10 years, I realized that that was the story that was really missing in American history to the war. This story of 10 years of warfare and what it was like day to day for people. And it was only hearing the Vietnamese tell me about this again and again that I finally got it through my thick skull that this is the essence of the war. And it really transformed the project for me.
Do you think that the draft
Well, you know, I get asked that a lot. I've never been able to see really any difference between, you know, and it's tough to tease it apart because the records are so fragmentary, but I never noticed a difference between men who were drafted, those who are enlisted, or those, the third big category is enlisted to avoid the draft. There were many men who volunteered for service to try and beat the draft and have some control over where they served in the military and in what branch. Have some control over their fate once they were in. I never did see a real difference. You know, the military, say in when the My Lai massacre was made public, they really tried to paint this as an aberrant unit, that these were the bottom of the barrel, the worst troops. And they, in their investigation, they really looked into the backgrounds of these guys, and. What they found was that it was no difference between the enlisted men and the draftees. But the investigation concluded with that this was a typical cross-section of American youth at the time, or at least American male youth. So they were, these were all American boys that committed this. And I did never see a difference in your draft status. And in many cases I saw officers, even West Point trained officers who, you know, they were really, you know, lousy leaders. You know, they tried to, with My Lai, always paint Lieutenant Calley, who's the one American who was convicted of crimes there, as an exceptionally poor officer. And I don't argue with it. He was exceptionally poor. But I've seen men who had the finest training the military had to offer who did the exact same things and handed down the same types of orders.
Okay, I have two questions. Okay. The first one, did you, in terms of the reports filed against American military vehicles to American military being assaulted, what were often the context that, or the impetus for why this was viewed as an assault and something worth documenting? I mean, with so much going on, you know, you had.
Why these cases and why they were investigated?
Was it by chance? Was it at random? Or was there, what was the either impetus or context for this becoming something to document as, you know, an assault that Americans were, because there's so much. Like,
yeah, why these particular cases and not others?
Was it at random again, or was there anything?
You know, the cases that were investigated, it was generally because there was, you know, one whistleblower who was adamant about making it public again and again. These men are very atypical. Some of them actually tried to blow the whistle in Vietnam, which was potentially lethal, and others who tried to get the word out when they came home. There's a lot of resistance to it, and so it was generally that someone cared enough to keep at it, and it was a rarity.
Did you ever interview either the whistleblower of any of these cases and or the team of people that built these
investigated?
Yeah, both.
I talked to a lot of whistleblowers, and if anyone wants to hear it, I can tell. I think I in one of the classes I told a whistleblower story. I could tell in detail, and I did talk to Army criminal investigators because I was very interested in a lot of these cases. They built very really solid cases. They did a great amount of investigation. However, in a lot of them, they strung the cases out over a long period of time until everyone had left military service. And I asked them if this was by design, and it certainly was. And I asked them, you know, why even go through the motions? And in some cases, they didn't. In some cases, military investigators told men, look, I really don't want to hear your story. You know, I'm not interested in investigating this. So if you tell me nothing, I can report nothing happened, and we can close the case. And that happened too. In other cases, the guys told me, you know, it's my job to do the investigation. And sometimes these were used as training cases, just to train people on how you conduct an investigation. And they really had no interest in having it go forward from there. So there were a lot of various reasons why these went forward and why others didn't. And it rarely seemed to be any rhyme or reason to it. But, It was depending on, you know, which unit took the investigation and who was working the case. So very varied.
Yeah. I was in the artillery in the war,
okay.
So I didn't have to see any of you. And I want to thank you for writing the book.
Oh, thank you.
The question is, what's the estimate of the civilians?
Yeah. It's very, very tough to get a handle on that. The best estimates that we have, extrapolating from a study that Harvard and the University of Washington did a couple years ago and from the Vietnamese government, is about 2 million Vietnamese killed, civilians killed, I should say. On top of that, if you use a conservative method of estimation, it's about 5 million Vietnamese who are wounded. Just to give you further indication of the scale of the suffering that went on, the U.S. military's, or the U.S. government's own estimates were about 11 million Vietnamese made refugees during the war. Very good study done in Science magazine a couple of years ago showed about 4 million or so Vietnamese exposed to toxic defoliants like Agent Orange. So in addition to hearing all the stories from Vietnamese civilians, when I thought about those numbers, I tried to grapple with what that could mean, millions of dead and wounded and those were forced into the slums or refugee camps, it really drove home to me the ubiquity of suffering and how when you read the histories of the war, you know, Vietnamese civilian suffering is generally condensed down to a paragraph on July, and that's about it. And when I thought about those numbers, about 2 million dead, I said, you know, this is the essence of the war. You know, there were 58,000 some odd Americans were killed, a horrendous toll, but I mean, the civilian number, of course, dwarfs this by exponentially.
I also wanted to thank you very personally for writing the book.
Thank you.
There are a lot of us Vietnam veterans walking around with very explicit experiences tattooed to our mind.
Sure.
The problem arises, as much as I would like to share that with my loved ones, specifically my grandkids, is just too difficult.
Yeah.
And your book, I hope when my grandkids get old enough, I can give them the book and then sort of as a third person or start a dialogue. So thank you so much.
Thank you. It's exceptionally heartening to hear.
I'll just add real quick, when the program is over, Nick will be in the back there. There are his books for sale. at a sale price, and Nick has graciously agreed to autograph the books if you'd like to put one on.
You know, what you said. You know, this is something that when I was doing interviews for this book with American veterans, it was often driven home to me. You know, I would call people up cold, out of the blue, or many times just go and knock cold on their door and show up, you know, 40 years after the fact. And I was always upfront with people. I told them immediately what I was there for. I have these records, a war crime investigation. You're named in the records, or I have your sworn statement. I want to talk to you about that. I'm going to write about this. I want your side of the story. And, you know, when I first started this, I expected that most doors would get slammed in my face, or people would slam down the receiver of the phone, and that would be it. But many men, you know, most of them were willing to talk. And I think, you know, for the reasons you mentioned, because they weren't able to talk to their families about it. This isn't something that you want to talk about with your kids or your grandkids. You don't want to bring up. You don't want to tell your friends about this in many cases, then who won't understand. But I think that because I showed up and I already sort of knew the story, you know, they figured that, I already knew the basics. So they were willing to talk to me because, you know, many of them had said they hadn't talked about it in 40 years, and they really wanted to talk about it. They've been grappling with it in silence for so long, and it finally gave them a chance to try and come to grips with it, talk it through, and also learn more about it, because they knew, you know, a fragment of the story, what they had seen, but they wanted to know what other men in the unit had seen and what they had said. So I think there was a hunger, you know, for some of these men to talk. Yeah.
Back to the comment about casualties, I think one of the many compelling things about your book is the casualties didn't end in 1975, and the work that you've done in country, and I know that veterans groups are doing in the country even today, dealing with the effects of the war. So the war is still going on.
Yeah.
It's going on here, it's going on there, and will continue to do so. I guess it was more of a different question, but
yeah.
Thank you for doing your work in Vietnam.
Thank you.
As well. And I would just say my real question is, what did you do with your copy?
The copies of the documents.
Not all been reclassified.
Yeah, I had made extra copies of these and passed them out to friends who lived elsewhere in the country. Not that I thought anything nefarious would happen. It's more that a fire or flood or something can wipe out all your documents, so I wanted them in different places. And so they're still scattered about, and mine are, unfortunately, in a mess from the fact check that was done on the book now going on 2 years, and I hope to get those documents back in order at some point, and one day I'd like to make them available, put them in a private, publicly accessible archive, it's a matter of finding the time for that, or get them digitized and put on the web. It's just
Meg, are you volunteering?
I'll definitely keep it in mind.
You mentioned how a lot of the records got pulled. Were there any other obstacles that you faced?
Yeah, I ran into a lot of obstacles in this reporting. Sometimes I'm trying to think of various different types. Sometimes I try and get records, and I find they were national security classified because they dealt with a foreign government. And I knew that the government they were talking about was the Republic of South Vietnam, a government that hasn't existed since 1975. I said, I doubt this could be a real problem for the South Vietnamese government since they haven't been in existence, these last decades now. But that was still an excuse that was used. I would file Freedom of Information Act requests for records, and sometimes it'd take up to 7 years to get the records released. A lot of these records have since disappeared various ways. The Marines accidentally destroyed a significant portion of their records. you know, court martial records, which are supposed to be kept in perpetuity. There's always supposed to be two copies of this that are kept, never destroyed. There's one case that I always comes to mind because there were two court martials that were undertaken of a Marine rifleman, young guy, and then his officer. The rifleman's case I had, so I FOIA'd up the officer's case, and it took 5 years. And finally, I heard from the declassification authority, and they said, okay, got good news and bad news for you. The bad news is that the entire court-martial, so this is like 500 pages of testimony, that's disappeared. We don't have it, but we can offer you something. So this court-martial transcript was kept inside a folder. We have that folder. We can offer you a copy of that. I said, you know, I didn't even know that I was hearing this right. I said, a copy of the folder that was around the case file. I said, yes. I said, you'll make copies of it. I said, yes, copy the front of the folder, the inside of the folder, the inside cover, the back cover, and the back inside. So, yeah, I mulled it over there on the phone. I said, you know what, you know, let me save the taxpayers' money and, you know, I'll forego that document. So, you know, these are the types of things that I ran into, you know, the problems with documents. And these are the troubles with you know, working with classified material. Is there some more?
Yeah, I think maybe we'll take two more questions.
So, and I'm very thankful for your talk today, and just want to ask you what you wanted to do after this book, you know, because you know that, you know, American History book hasn't reflected well on the side of the war.
Yeah.
So, do you plan to do anything about it, you know, educate people more about the side that they haven't known for so long?
Well, you know, I've spent the last year out on the road talking about the book. I, of course, want to get it out there. I'm happy to say it's been translated into Vietnamese and can be available in Vietnam, or I think it is actually right now, finally. You know, I think I'll probably take a break from writing about Vietnam for a while. You know, it's a 10-year project, and, you know, I'm still enmeshed in national security issues and still report on that on a regular basis, but I think a little bit of a break from Vietnam for the moment. But, you know, it's a story that I really do want to get out there, and as long as audiences like this will you know, bear listening to me, I'm happy to go out and continue to talk about it, because I think it's important to set the history straight, and then, you know, I also hope that it has some resonance for the current wars, that, you know, civilian casualties don't generally lead the nightly news, they don't come on the, you know, show up on the front page of the newspaper all the time, and I really hope that, you know, in some small way, I could hope to introduce that conversation. I hope that some of my colleagues in the field of journalism would to take a look at the book and hopefully devote a little more time to that. So,
okay, I wanted to ask, because this is a new Boston session. I mean, I don't know any of the myths about the Vietnamese War. I mean, I didn't get here, so I would like to know some of the myths and what she did to Boston.
Sure. You know, the major thing that I tried to do with the book was to get civilians back in the picture. You know, there are 30,000 books in print on the Vietnam War, but if you want to try and get a sense of what civilians went through during the war, it's almost non-existent. As I mentioned, it's really distilled down to a page or a paragraph on My Lai, on one incident. But I wanted to get across the day-to-day, so that was the major thing that I wanted to address. You know, American histories are generally focused on military history, political history, diplomatic history, and very good at that. But I wanted to get this story front and center. And I hope that, in the future, those in the literature will maybe devote a few more pages to that side of the story. That was the major thing I wanted to get across.
Yes, I also get a nick, and the first I want to share is the fact that even a mistake book, there is also no account on how many civilians were killed in the war. Because we also had our propaganda, and we try to keep it so that we try to glorify our work. But that's another question here.
Sure.
My question is, do you think the government will, the US government would ever do anything about it, or it just going to be happened and just going to be the same, the Iraq war or any other war?
Yeah, I mean, it's very, I don't think the U.S. government will do very much about it. I mean, in the case of Vietnam, it's taken now 40 years before they're devoting any kind of money to Agent Orange remediation, a very small amount, certainly nothing on the scale of what's necessary for remediation in the country. And that was only, grudgingly after a long period of time. There's still no money made available for all the unexploded ordnance that was mentioned in the country. So when you can't allocate funds for that, I certainly don't think there's any political will to prosecute cases this long after the fact. And I'm afraid that in Iraq and Afghanistan we'll see a repeat of these types of scenarios. That it's very tough for the U.S. military to do, they're not apt to do a lot of soul searching on these topics. And of course, there were some very introspective journals that generals that I talked to in this who thought they'd maybe done the wrong thing at the time in keeping these records secret. But whenever the war is fresh, there's no will, and then time passes, and it becomes ancient history, and we're on to generally a new war. So.
With new mythologies.
Yes, indeed.
Anyway, I want to thank you.
Spending a decade writing books. I couldn't imagine doing something like that myself. What do you think about the government, Vietnamese government, accounts on the war? Do you include it in your books?
The
Vietnamese government's accounts of the war?
Yeah, I mean, as you said, it's really, the civilians aren't in that literature because it's all one heroic people's war. So I always found the Vietnamese history is kind of stilted in a way because it's sort of this official history, and you don't get a lot of the texture of the war. And a lot of the villages I went to, I mean, they really were tied into the revolution, but it didn't mean that there weren't women and children there who were civilians. I really hope that one day there'll be Vietnamese scholars who kind of relegate my book to the dustbin of history and write a book. I think mine is still focused too much on Americans, and it's a fact of writing it for an American audience, but I really hope that there'll be Vietnamese scholars who can do a much better job than I can in telling the story.
Yeah. I remember a few years ago that I heard on the news that the Vietnamese government or some Vietnamese group tried to do a lawsuit in regard to the Agent Orange and try to get compensation for it.
Right.
I didn't know the result, though. I guess that they didn't get a lot.
It was thrown out of court. Mm-hmm. They said that they didn't have standing to sue. So while American veterans were able to get money, they said that the Vietnamese didn't have standing in the court to get it. That the companies that created Agent Orange, because they had contracts with the U.S. government, they were absolved of wrongdoing. So this is the, this is how they built up this.
And we can sue the U.S. government.
Yeah, that's the problem.
Okay. I guess, I'm going to share with you the new generation of Vietnamese thing that, see that even the people who actually have to live through the war, they don't have a lot of resentment.
No.
And the new generation, we certainly don't.
Yeah.
But we still want to see the compensation or something of social justice.
Certainly.
I
don't think they're going to do it.
I would just hope that the U.S. government take it as a case, or some or people take it as a case, and to avoid the same thing happening in the world.
Yeah, I wish they would. So. Thank you for coming out. I appreciate it.
Hello, my name is Edregard.
Hi.
Hello. I apologize for my ignorance. I've never read a good book. This is a little bit more personal. I have two children. I need to be interviewed with Vietnam veterans that have a story that is incredibly important. It ties to Vietnam. But are you open to? I need someone to speak to you about the interview process. And both of these people that you brought up, I know. Their stories need to be is there any way I can get a hold of you to ask? It almost as a mentor. It is very important, and I think you would, once I give you the information about it, you would understand.
You can reach me at, make it really easy. It's just nickturse@gmail.com. So it's just my name.
Okay, Gmail. At Gmail.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And it goes straight to you.
Yeah,
okay.
That's straight to me. I'm traveling a lot, so it takes me a while to respond, but I will certainly try and get back to you. This is a project you want to work on? You want to interview these people?
It's not necessarily that I want to do it, but I know it has to be done.
Yeah. Okay.
And I've been told it has to be done, and consent and of one.
Okay, yeah, just send me an email.
All right, thank you. Thanks, it's nice to meet you.
Good to thanks for coming out tonight.
How's it going?
Hi.
Really, it's really interesting to come to this talk. From a lot of the talks that we go for teachers, and most of them kind of fall asleep. And this one, really, for me, meant a lot. And my grandma's Korean War, so it's
okay.
Kind of like a Christmas story about different wars.
When
you took on a project, did you think it was going to take this long?
I thought maybe a couple of years working on it, and it ended up being, 11-year odyssey.
Yeah.
The project changed on me, as I went through it, and I realized.
Snowballed and kept getting bigger and bigger.
It did, and I had to try and find a way to condense it all, which was very difficult for me. It went on much longer than I ever expected.
And my other question was, when you take on a project this big, you did all the research, you went to Vietnam, did you have to fund all that yourself, or did you get someone?
Yeah, I strung together a lot of grants and fellowships over the years. I had a couple academic fellowships, Harvard and NYU, that put me up while I wrote sections of the book. And there were some foundations, Pulitzer Center for Crisis Reporting and stuff. They'd send me to Vietnam and to report other stories, and I do this in my spare time there. So. I really had to cobble together the funding.
Yeah, I was going to ask that question, just how would you fund it? Because you can't fund it yourself. You got all that research, you can't work.
Yeah, it wasn't the easiest thing to do, but I always felt it was, it was necessary in some way for me to do it. So I tried to find a way, but it's a real shoestring effort.
Yeah.
But luckily, you can work in Southeast Asia for a long time on very little money if you're willing to stay.
And then you get all the payoff in the end. So how many books did you sell all together?
I haven't gotten in my sales numbers from last year yet. I made the Times bestseller list for a couple weeks, which is more than I ever expected in the book, but I don't have good numbers in yet, so I'm not sure.
All right, well, thank you very much.
Thank you for coming.
I'm actually going to read this book now.
I appreciate you coming up.
Have a good one.
Thank you very much for your hard work.
Oh.
I'm just wondering, do you cover Operation Phoenix, all the in the CIA?
That
was an assassination
program,
wasn't it? And what I've read is about 10,000 targets?
Yeah, Bill Colby, who ran that program.
And became the head of the CIA.
Yeah. He the number he gave in 1971 in front of the Senate, it's in the book, something like 20,000 eliminations, as they call it, in Vietnam. Yeah, neutralized. Yeah. Members of the enemy infrastructure.
But generally, I heard that could be played.
They found out, and I have a quote in there from the Pentagon where they knew that they were just being used as a means to get rid of one's enemies in Vietnam.
All the time now. Like,
you know, a number of people have written really detailed books on Phoenix, so I only devote a little bit of time to the book, maybe a couple pages to it, because there have been, you know, book-length studies on it. But it is in there, and there are people who have done really extensive work.
The first time I heard the phrase "culminated moves," I was in rehab with a combat veteran.
Really?
Young guy from Wisconsin when he was in Vietnam, 18, 19 years old.
Yeah.
And he just said, yeah, that he was ordered, premeditated to shoot anything that moved.
Yeah. And you know, I heard that phrase over and over again.
His second wife caught him trying to kill himself in the garage, stringing himself up. Nice guy, soft-spoken.
Yeah.
Never guessed. But I don't know if you've run across stories like that. But
PTSD was a big time.
And that was before they called it PTSD.
Right, right.
But that was back in 81 that I knew him. But it was Roger Cusick. Always remember that guy. But thanks again.
But thank you for coming out tonight.
Thank you.
Hey.
Hey.
How's it going?
Good. Well, yeah, I really appreciate you coming out here today.
Oh,
it's been very interesting. Speak to you now three times.
Well, I really appreciate you sticking through.
Enough, yes.
Okay, good, good. Wow. You know, some of it, you know, you just say the same things again and again.
Yeah, but no, it's definitely very informative. And
great.
Make sure
bearing with me.
Some light summer reading.
Yeah, indeed. And make this out to you?
Sure.
Okay.
Chris.
Spelled the normal way?
Yeah.
Okay.
Unless your normal way is with a K at it.
It's not an easy read, but... I'm hopeful that it does a little bit of good. So,
all right.
Thank you very much.
It's been a pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, and thank you for the advice. I'll definitely look into John Bowers.
Yeah. At least if you can take a look, he's a spectacular writer. So okay. It's worth it for the writing alone.
Yeah.
Okay.
Jenny, JENNIE.
Okay.
Willie, be creative.